Hello students, today I will be teaching about the topic monitoring of critically ill patients in ICU. So let us see. Okay, so in ICUs specifically patients are there, like patients who are critically ill, okay, and who needs proper monitoring, who needs very important monitoring 24 hours. So this type of monitoring is we will talk about today, that is critical care monitoring. So there are many reasons why a patient may need critical care and monitoring. It maybe depends on the patient's disease condition, like heart failure or pneumonia, seizures, okay, or any other disease of the other organs like pancreas, liver, kidneys, okay, or having any other complications. Then such patients, they require 24 hours critically care monitoring. So the status of critically ill patient may change rapidly, either in response to therapies or to their underlying disease. So the patient's condition also will depend. Okay, it'll depend on the basis of their treatment, whatever medication, whatever treatment the patient is getting. So his life will depend upon the treatment or management. And some patients will have complications, or they will have other secondary infections. So all these we have to monitor. As a nurse, we have to assess and we have to check for all these. Changes in status of patient should be recorded and acted on rapidly. So all the changes in the person's or the patient's condition, they should be documented in the ICU chart and acted on rapidly. Early detection of deterioration or complication will give the best chance of successful intervention to address the problem. So by having a proper monitoring of the patient, therefore we can detect if there's any complication, if there's any other problems in the patient. A good critical care nurse will think ahead and anticipate problems and complications before they happen. It is important that any instructions on the patient's care are clarified, and the nurse should feel confident to ask the clinician or the doctors questions and make suggestions to allow the best nursing care. So, in order to provide the best nursing care to the patient, therefore the nurse, the critical care nurse or the ICU nurse, should have very good information, should have high knowledge about the disease condition of the patient, and she should feel confident, and she should have confidence also in providing the medications and providing care to the patient. So there are many types of monitoring. Okay, so let us see first with the hands-on monitoring. Okay, so hands-on monitoring, like for example, we have to check the patient's pulse or patient's heart rate, okay, quality, mucous membrane, quality of the mucous membrane, whether it's thick or it is serous or it is what color is the mucous membrane, all that we have to check. Then also the capillary refill time. Next, we also check the respiratory rate and the efforts. Okay, whether the patient is struggling to take in the oxygen, or patient is having any dyspnea or tachypnea. So all these we have to monitor. Next, we have to monitor for chest auscultation as well. Okay, then we check the temperature, both axillary and rectal temperature, and we have to check the body weight. So these are some of the hands-on monitoring. Next, coming to the neurological monitoring. So neurological, you have studied about this in psychiatry, right? So the very important scale that we use in neurological monitoring is Glasgow Coma Scale. So in neurological monitoring, what do we check with the patient? We check how, if the patient is alert or patient is dull, okay, or patient is in coma. Then we also check if the patient pupil size, the pupils are symmetry or not, and if there's any light reflexes in the pupils. So that also will have to be checked. And we will check for pain sensation, whether the patient is having any sensation of pain, okay, or it is numb or paralyzed, and we have to check for withdrawal of reflexes. Okay, so these all that comes under the neurological monitoring. Then other monitorings are like इलेक्ट्रोकार्डियोग्राम, ईसीजी। ओके, सो ईसीजी, कंटिन्यूस ईसीजी इज सम पेशेंट्स रिक्वायर कंटिन्यूस ईसीजी। व्हाई? बिकॉज टू चेक फॉर द एनी डिसरिथमियस, ओके, और एनी अबनॉर्मल रिदम और एनी चेंजिंग ऑफ द हार्ट रेट। ओके, रैपिड चेंजेस ऑफ द हार्ट रेट ऑल्सो, सो सच पेशेंट्स रिक्वायर कंटिन्यूस ईसीजी मॉनिटरिंग। ओके, एंड इट इज यूजफुल फॉर मॉनिटरिंग पेशेंट्स विद इंट्राक्रेनियल डिजीज और हाइपो हाइपरकलेमिया, दैट इज व्हेन देयर इज एन इंक्रीज पोटेशियम लेवल इन द ब्लड। सो व्हेन द पोटेशियम लेवल इज इंक्रीज इन द ब्लड, देन पेशेंट विल हैव डिसरिथमियास, ओके, और अबनॉर्मल हार्ट रिदम। नेक्स्ट मॉनिटरिंग इज द आर्टेरियल ब्लड प्रेशर। ओके, सो आर्टेरियल ब्लड प्रेशर कैन बी मेजर्ड बाई डायरेक्ट और इनडायरेक्ट मेथड। ओके, सो बाय अ डायरेक्ट मेथड यू विल इंसर्ट एन आर्टेरियल कैथेटर, एंड बाय अ इनडायरेक्ट मेथड बाय यूजिंग अ डॉपलर। ओके, सो बाय परफॉर्मिंग आर्टेरियल ब्लड प्रेशर वी विल बी एबल टू गेट द और टू डिटेक्ट द सिस्टोलिक, द डायस्टोलिक एंड द मीन प्रेशर ऑफ द पेशेंट। नेक्स्ट मॉनिटरिंग इज पल्स ऑक्सीमेट्री। सो दिस इज पल्स ऑक्सीमेट्री इज अ वेरी सिंपल मॉनिटरिंग। ओके, वी जस्ट नीड the pulse oximeter and we just put it on the patient's digits or the patient's fingers, and what do we check? We will check for the hemoglobin saturation, okay, the oxygen. So that is very important. Next, end-tidal carbon dioxide. So it provides a measure of the amount of carbon dioxide which is present in the exhaled air. So when the patient is exhaling the air, is throwing out the air from the lungs. Okay, so how much carbon dioxide is present in that exhaled air? So this we will monitor by using the end-tidal carbon dioxide monitoring. Next, other monitorings like blood glucose. Okay, glucose monitoring to measure the blood glucose level, the electrolytes. Okay, we have to check whether the magnesium level is normal or the sodium level is normal or potassium level is normal or calcium level is normal. So all that we can check by the electrolyte. Next is the venous or arterial blood gas, ABG. Okay, so that is to check the pH, the carbon dioxide, okay, the bicarbonate ions. Then clotting parameters. Okay, what is the platelet count and the blood smear examination. So these are some of the other monitoring techniques. Next, fluid balance is often disrupted in critical patients. Okay, so critically ill patients or patients in ICUs who require continuous monitoring. So such patients, they may have fluid imbalance. Okay, so we have to check the input and output. Okay, in an ICU chart, there is a specific input-output monitoring. Okay, input and output. Okay, so let us see what are the ins. Okay, inputs. The ins, meaning that you are taking something inside. So ins is like water consumption, drinking water. Okay, nutrition, either by enteral or parenteral, either by through mouth or through total parenteral nutrition, and parenteral fluid therapy or IV fluids. Okay, so all these will be considered under the inputs, that is the ins. Now the output, that is coming out. Okay, so like urine, what is the urine volume, feces, how many times the patient has passed stool, vomitus, okay, what is how much what is the color of vomitus and how many times, then fluid loss from wounds and fluid loss into the body cavity. So these are some of the outputs. Okay, next, pain management assessment. So this is also another type of monitoring that we have to monitor as a nurse, that is pain. Okay, so some patients, those patients who are in coma, they will not, you know, they will not be able to express their pain. Okay, so those stable patients, we have to ask. Okay, we have to assess their pain. How much pain are you having out of 10 by using numerical pain rating scale? So we can ask the patient from 0 to 10 how much pain the patient is having. Okay, so all that we have to assess. Next, monitoring indwelling catheters and other tubes. So we have to monitor the IV tubes, whether the IV tube is in the IV catheters, it is in place or not. ओके, और इट इज डिसलोकेटेड, और इफ इट इज डिसलोकेटेड देन देयर विल बी स्वेलिंग, ओके, एंड देयर विल बी पेन. सो वी हैव टू चेक ऑल दिस. देन वी हैव टू चेक द इनडवेलिंग कैथेटर, द फॉलीज कैथेटर आल्सो, ओके, वेदर इट इज इन प्लेस और इट हैज कम आउट, ओके, एंड वी हैव टू चेक फॉर द अदर ट्यूब्स लाइक ड्रेनेज ट्यूब्स, ओके, और then we have to check the ETT tubes also, whether they are in place or not. So all these monitoring are important. Next, drug therapies. Okay, as a nurse, as a critical care nurse, okay, she should have high knowledge about the drugs. What are the drugs that are used in ICUs? Okay, what are their actions? Okay, how much dose is required to the patient? Okay, what is the side effects? And what is the interaction, okay, the action of drugs, the side effects, the indication, when to give this drug or when not to give this drug, indication, contraindication, action, side effects, and the dosage. So all these a nurse should have very good information. Next, keeping good records. Okay, even though in wards also records are being maintained, documentation is being maintained, right? In patient, there is patient's file. Okay, patient's file will consist of you know, the doctor's records. Okay, then we will have the nurse's records also. Nurse's records will include the nursing care plan, then the input output chart, okay, the temperature TPR chart. Okay, so all these are to be documented. So in ICU, okay, specifically in ICU, there is a ICU chart. Okay, all of you must have seen the ICU charts. Okay, so within the ICU charts, there are many columns. Okay, which a nurse should, you know, like should fill up the important documentation. Okay, so so keeping good records is very important. Okay, because that will help in the patient's life. Okay, the quality, how to improve the quality of life of the patient is by keeping the records also. Next, so there are other monitoring techniques. Okay, so like there are invasive monitoring. Invasive meaning that something is, it is invasive, meaning it is going inside the body. Okay, so invasive monitorings are invasive blood pressure monitoring. Okay. IV invasive BP monitoring. So invasive BP monitoring, okay, so it is or intra-arterial blood pressure. It is commonly used technique in ICUs. It involves direct pressure or it involves direct measurement of the blood, of the arterial pressure, by inserting a cannula needle into the suitable artery. Okay, so what do we do here? We check for a suitable artery, and then we insert a cannula. Okay, we will insert a cannula needle into the artery, and we will measure the arterial pressure. Next is the CVP monitoring, central venous pressure monitoring. So CVP pressure, okay, CV pressure, central venous pressure. It is a pressure which is measured in the central veins. Okay, and it is close to the heart. This indicates the mean right atrial pressure, and it is frequently used as an estimate of right ventricle preload. Okay, so CVP monitoring is also very important, where we check the pressure of the central vein. Next, we have the pulmonary artery catheterization, PAC, pulmonary artery catheterization. It is a procedure in which an intravascular catheter is inserted through a central vein. Okay, the central vein can be femoral or jugular vein or antecubital vein or the brachial vein, and will connect it to the right. This is connected to the right side of the heart and advance towards the pulmonary artery. So we will insert a catheter into the central vein. Okay, and from there we will move towards the pulmonary artery, and we will measure the pressure. So this is pulmonary artery catheterization. Next, we have the ABG analysis. ABG analysis is very commonly performed in the ICUs. So ABG is arterial blood gas analysis. We will get a more information about the pH of the patient. Okay, the PO2, PCO2, saturation of oxygen, bicarbonate ions, and the base excess. So let us see the components of ABG. Like I said, pH, PaCO2, PaO2, partial pressure of oxygen, bicarbonate ions, saturation of oxygen, and the base excess. Okay, so the normal values are pH. Normal range, okay, the normal pH of a normal person is 7.35 to 7.45. Partial pressure of carbon dioxide, 35 to 45 mmHg. PaO2 is 80 to 100 mmHg. Bicarbonate ions, 21 to 27, that is a normal. Saturation of oxygen, 95 to 100%. And the base excess is plus minus 2 milli equivalent per liter. So this is the normal values or the normal characteristics of ABG analysis. Now what happens is in ABG analysis, why do we do ABG analysis? To detect if there's any respiratory acidosis, alkalosis, metabolic acidosis, metabolic alkalosis. So when do we confirm that the patient is having respiratory acidosis? So this is a simple table. Okay, with the help of this table, you will be able to remember. Okay, so you just remember the arrows and the levels, the ABG components and the disease condition on the left side. Okay, so on the left side, you will keep the disease condition, that is respiratory acidosis, respiratory alkalosis, metabolic acidosis, and metabolic alkalosis. Okay. So for now, you in one column you keep the pH level, PaCO2 and HCO3, bicarbonate. Okay, so now what you do is, okay, so if the pH, okay, after taking the ABG analysis of the patient, okay, you're getting the result. Now from there you will see if the pH of the patient is low, okay, and PaCO2 level is high and bicarbonate ions is high, then we can consider the patient is having respiratory acidosis. Then if the patient, the pH of the patient is high, but PaCO2 and HCO3 is low, then we consider it as respiratory alkalosis. Next, metabolic acidosis. If pH is low, PaCO2 is low, but and even this HCO3 is low, then we can consider it as metabolic acidosis. Okay, so you can see all the arrows are down. Okay, when all the arrows are down, means that the patient is having metabolic acidosis. And if all the arrows are up, means that all the levels, the pH level, the PaCO2 level, and HCO3 level, they are high, meaning that they are exceeding from the normal level. Then we can see that the patient is having metabolic alkalosis. Okay, so this is how you interpret ABG analysis. Next, apart from ABG analysis, we have the ICP monitoring, that is the intracranial monitoring. Okay, intracranial pressure, it is a pressure which is present in the CSF, okay, in the brain. Okay, so ICP monitoring is a diagnostic test that helps the doctor to determine whether the patient is having high CSF pressure or low CSF pressure. CSF is cerebrospinal fluid. The test measures the pressure in your head directly using a small pressure sensitive probe that is inserted through the skull. So a sensitive a probe will be inserted into the skull, and with the help of that probe, we will be able to measure the pressure of the CSF. Indication for ICP monitoring. Okay, patients who had head injury or intracerebral hemorrhage, subarachnoid hemorrhage, hydrocephalus, cerebrovascular stroke, cerebral edema, or brain tumors. Then in such cases, such disease conditions, we will monitor the intracranial pressure. Next, the last monitoring is the intra-abdominal pressure. It monitors the pressure inside the abdomen. So the normal IAP value, it ranges between 0 to 5. Okay, so it should not be more than 5 mmHg. Direct measurements of intra-abdominal pressure with an intra-peritoneal catheter are precise. So here also we will insert a catheter into the peritoneum and we will measure the abdominal pressure. It is less invasive and inexpensive technique of intravascular manometry is the recommended standard. So there are four grades of intra-abdominal hypertension. Okay, so if the pressure of the abdominal is more than 5 mmHg, then we can say that the patient is having hypertension. Okay, so based on this, there are four grades. One is grade 1, when intra-abdominal pressure is between 12 to 15 mmHg. Okay, and if IAP is between 16 to 20, then we can say it is grade 2. IAP is between 21 to 25 mmHg, we can say grade 3. And if it is more than 25, then it is grade 4. Okay, and such conditions we can monitor, and patients with severe acute pancreatitis then should be monitored for intra-abdominal pressure. Okay, so these are some of the monitoring that a nurse, okay, an ICU nurse should follow. Okay, so thank you, class. I hope the topic for today is simple. Okay, we have done this topic in the previous classes, so this is just a revision for you. Thank you, class.